the third sector on this lap number 15.
He's just keeping it 1.5, 1.6 seconds. All the time. At the moment, the same energy as over half distance, he seems in no trouble. Through the Ferrari corner into turn 13, when he crosses the line, there will be 12 to go for Danny Pedrosa. Chasing his third MotoGP win here in Jerez.
I've got to say, Jorge Lorenzo has not been able to drop the challenge. Joan Zarco just yet, there they are at the top of your picture. The two Repsol Honda men under the spaceship here on the start-finish straight in Jerez. Lorenzo's not been able to shrug off Zarco at all. They came over the line with almost identical lap times.
Here he goes up the inside to Valentino Rossi. Real pressure from Petrucci, must have got past him. Did he?
Yeah, Petrucci had already moved through on Valentino Rossi. Maybe with a move at the final corner.
Just keep it. Got it down to 1.3 now.
They've got a bit tight.
They're good mates, aren't they? Petrucci and Rossi.
Yeah, that got tight. There was probably a little bit of contact there between Petrucci and Rossi. They came on that flip-flop out of turns 2 and 3. Rossi's struggling here. You can see Petrucci's got the better pace. Up the inside of Rossi through the Cito Ponce corner. Valentino Rossi. He's on a bit of an knife edge here with his grip.
Yeah, he dare push too hard. He could still just about be leading that world championship on the brakes, but he's not going to overbrake Petrucci into the dry sack.
The problem is, like Vinales and Dovizioso, while Rossi tosses with Petrucci, Vinales and Dovizioso ahead of a clearing off. They're getting a bit of daylight in that battle for fifth. We're on board with Vinales. This is through turn 8, the Jorge Martinez Aspar corner. Can't shrug off Dovizioso.
I say, Dovizioso's done a good job, and he's done a good job starting so far back on the grid. It's a good job now to hang in there with Vinales.
So when Danny Pedrosa comes over the line to start lap 16, he'll see on his pit board the smallest margin between himself and Marc Marquez in this race. So how will he react to that? Will he start worrying about his tyres dropping off, or Marc Marquez's tyres having that better performance with the hard rear towards the end of the race?
Tell you what, they're all having a few problems, aren't they? Vinales followed by Dovizioso and Petrucci and Rossi. What's the gap? 1.1. He's pulled back another two-tenths, Marc Marquez. Is it going to happen? 11 to go.
Yeah, you can see Valentino Rossi's a bit of a passenger on the top of that movie star Yamaha, because Danilo Petrucci is already able to pull a little bit of an advantage on him. There's the lap progression over the last three laps for Pedrosa and Marquez. It's been the last two laps where Marquez has taken about half a second out of his teammate. That's the only difference between the two of them, the rear tyre selection of Danny Pedrosa. That medium option rear tyre, he knew that was going to give him an advantage in the first half of this race, and he's built up a pretty decent buffer, but we expected Marquez to come on strong in the second half of the race, and that's exactly at the moment how it appears to be panning out.
What do you think, Dylan? Is there that big a difference? Well, because they've been absolutely battered the whole time, the tyres, aren't they, these conditions?
Yeah, but you know, I think there is still about one third of the race to go, and do you know what, you've just got to think that they don't drop off like a cliff, but you've got to check there. I mean, look, Danny Pedrosa, you can just see there the front wearing that little bit. You've got that slightly darker patch, great shot, and that's certainly going to be playing on his mind. And look how much Pedrosa dropped off in Austin. Marquez is definitely going to be thinking about that.
Yeah, Danny Pedrosa had massive braining on the front tyre at the Circuit of the Americas in Austin. That's why he had to call off the battle against Marc Marquez initially for the win, and then the battle for second place with Valentino Rossi.
Well, they tend to go when they cross the line. What will the gap be? Will it be below 1 second?
Yeah, I think Marquez is smelling blood here a little bit. Over the line they come. It's 1.1 seconds. They came around last time around with the exact same lap time.
Yeah.
Pedrosa 1:48.79, matched exactly by Marc Marquez. Absolutely nothing between the two Repsol Honda men.
This is the battle between Vinales and
Vinales wide, well wide.
So moments there for him.
You know, that's the game, probably just running out a bit of grip on that front tyre. Although he would have been feeling the pressure and the heat from Andrea Dovizioso, so he's got to do the hard work all over again now, Maverick Vinales. The live championship standing is getting pretty tight at the top.
It's just down to four now. Rossi would have worked this out in his head. He may not know where Maverick Vinales is exactly in the race, but if he can leave here after a very, very tough weekend, still leading the World Championship, I think he'd shake your hand now and say, put the chequered flag out.
Definitely. Yeah, he's about a second slower than the race leader, Dani Pedrosa, is Valentino Rossi. There's going to be no fairy tale second victory in succession here in Jerez. It won't be Valentino Rossi's name that goes to the record books as the winner of the 3000th Grand Prix. Down now to about a second. Marquez on this lap has picked up another tenth.
Yeah, can he get it down to below a second? Through the Ferrari corner comes Pedrosa. And then on the brakes, the Lorenzo left-hander. And he crosses the line, there'll be nine laps to go, and he does scent a little bit of blood, does Marc Marquez. But again, he'll be careful. He knows that 20 points is better than none.
Yeah, you can see Marquez, how hard he was pushing through turn number 12. He was getting that rear tyre pumping. Again, Marquez a fraction faster last time around, but Pedrosa,
a fraction,
yeah,
isn't it?
He can keep that 1 second buffer. Lorenzo and Johann Zarco are really holding station. The two of them are on board now with Lorenzo. Have been split by about 2.5 tenths for the last five or six laps. Lorenzo defending that final podium place, Dylan.
Yeah, sorry guys, I just wanted to give you a quick update on Tito Rabat. The team said he's in the clinical because he banged his head, but they say that he is okay.
Poor old Tito Rabat. Yeah, Zarco's done an absolutely super job. And you wouldn't put it past him to have a go on the last couple of laps away, Lorenzo, would you?
For the first time in this race since lap one or two, the gap between Pedrosa and Marquez is down to a second, only by a fraction, but he's psychologically, that's going to be important.
He's eking away at him.
Danny Pedrosa's that big carrot dangling right in front of Marc Marquez, isn't he? Has Lorenzo broken the result with Zarco?
No, I don't think he has. This is a battle for third place. Lorenzo would be an amazing third place for him and Ducati. Could end on the podium in just the fourth race. Hervé Poncharal looks on. The lads are doing a good, very good job indeed for him, because Zarco running fourth and Folger running in ninth place. Not quite close enough at the moment, is he, Zarco?
No.
And he's not a guy that settles for anything simple, is he?
No, we know Jorge Lorenzo. He's famous for being one of the smoothest riders in the history of the sport. If anybody can nurse those medium tyres home to podium place, it will be Jorge Lorenzo. Pedrosa over the line, he's exactly 1 second again. They almost again did identical lap times. There's nothing to split these two in terms of lap times. It's going to be all about grip and particular rear grip. They've both got that same hard option front tyre on. It's all about rear tyre management now for Dani Pedrosa with, what, just under 8 laps remaining.
This is going to be a mighty interesting 8 laps here. The 3,000th solo Grand Prix in the history of Grand Prix racing. The fourth round of this year's World Championship. First round in Europe. Pedrosa's led from start to finish. Marquez, I might say he's hunting him down, but he's just eking away. Pedrosa has ridden quite brilliantly at the front, but tyre choice could be crucial.
I bet Marquez feels like somebody who's just, you know when you're trying to get through a stiff door, you keep banging your shoulder on it, but you can't just quite get through it. That's exactly what he feels like right now, because he's trying absolutely everything, but he just can't exert enough pressure on Dani Pedrosa, who, you've got to say at the moment, Dani Pedrosa's ridden a picture-perfect race. He's been faultless. He hasn't put a tyre out of line at the moment, Dani Pedrosa.
Certainly hasn't, and we don't want to do the commentator's curse on him, but he has been absolutely brilliant at the front. To the stadium section they come, crowd on their feet, through the Alex Crevier corner. There is the race pace for Dani Pedrosa. Now through the Ferrari corner.
Pedrosa has not dropped into the 141s throughout the whole race. It's been superb tyre management with that medium rear tyre from Dani Pedrosa. That is what you call phenomenal consistency.
Seven to go and they cross the line. What is the gap? 1.3. He has increased it and he's up at turn one.
Well, we talked about Pedrosa protecting his tyres. You know, he's putting pressure on Marquez to maybe abuse his own, because he hasn't given Marquez a sniff. We know that Marc Marquez can overheat that hard option front tyre. Rossi's coming under pressure here from
Jonas Folger. Rossi's dropped down to 142.572. He's a bit of a sitting duck here as the world championship leader.
There's nothing he can do, Valentino Rossi. He must finish the race. And he will finish the race, but you get the feeling just looking at that picture that Folger will probably get past him in the next 6.5 laps. We ride her with Valentino Rossi. Folger, former Moto2 winner here, right behind him in 9th place.
Yeah, there's plenty of time for Jonas Folger to make a move. He's swarming all over the back of Valentino Rossi here. Surely he's going to make the move. Rossi just hasn't got the drive grip. Turn number 5. We know that Rossi's absolutely superb on the brakes. Jonas Folger will only pass the 9 times world champion when he knows it can be absolutely safe and secure.
Yeah, because who's behind Folger? It's a Aleix Espargaró. What's the between them? 2 seconds, we did just get a little glimpse of him. Yeah, Folger surely will bide his time as a race winner. He's a race winner here in the Moto2 class.
Well, we're not going to do anything that's going to risk taking Valentino Rossi out of the race, because that will be a bit of a career-limiting move at Yamaha for Jonas Folger.
His factory contract would be, if there ever was one, ripped up. Not easy for Valentino Rossi, but showing all his experience. The gap at the front, 1.3 still. This is the fight for, if you believe, 8th place. And Jonas Folger and Rossi, and Rossi just looks on and says, there is absolutely nothing like it.
You don't see, no disrespect to Jonas Folger, you just don't see rookies making moves that easy on Valentino Rossi. He's in so much trouble with that rear tyre, probably with both tyres, Rossi, as well. He's struggling with the front and the rear. Just, as we said, he's a bit of a passenger at the moment on that factory Yamaha. Back to 9th.
Yeah, and I tell you what, Aleix Espargaró is probably sniffing a bit of blood as well. There he is on the Aprilia, running in 10th place. There is Aleix Espargaró. He's got his debut here 30 years ago.
Vizioso, Scott Vinales covered as well, isn't it? Because that gap between those two in the back of the fifth now over a second in favour of the Vizioso. This is where Dani Pedrosa has been superb all weekend. The 3rd and 4th sectors where he's had brilliant pace. He was so fast through turns 8 and 9 right here on the course now that Marc Marquez has been looking at the Pedrosa data in the garage. Said that was the reason why Marquez hooked in behind Pedrosa in qualifying, because he just wanted to see a few tricks of the trade, why Danny was so quick in this part of the circuit. So this is where Pedrosa, you would feel, has that clear advantage over Marquez, who again, he just cannot get close enough to get the hooks into Danny Pedrosa.
1.2 with 5.5 laps to go. Turn 13, we had a look at Marquez. Sete Gimeno, rider coach to Dani Pedrosa. We'll be mighty pleased with his work. He crosses the line now.
What a weekend it's been for Dani Pedrosa. Let's not forget, before today, he'd had no front row in 11 races, no pole position in 19, only 2 podiums in his last 11 races. Lorenzo, he's definitely broken Johan Zarco. Zarco is now 1.5 seconds back. We're on board with the Frenchman, who's put up an absolutely terrific fight for the podium. A valiant fight, producing fireworks again in the first few laps with breathtakingly brilliant moves on the likes of Iannone, Vinales and Rossi.
What's so great about this championship is something different.
Espargaró's got Rossi, Nick. Sorry, you said.
Rossi is really struggling. Who's after Espargaró?
Valentino, he's dropped into the 143s here, Rossi. What's the gap there now, Mr. Wise? There's a huge buffer back to Scott Redding.
That is it, probably, isn't it?
But Aleix Espargaró lighting up that Aprilia through turn number 4. Has Rossi run on here?
He has.
You know what's happened? Rossi has just got absolutely zero front tyre left. That's the second time we've seen him make a mistake. He made a mistake at turn 6. Made a mistake there, Rossi. It's like, we said, a sitting duck. This has been pretty demoralising and deflating for a rider like Rossi. He's just about, though, clinging on. He has a good long look over his shoulder there. He'll thankfully see nobody else dropping him further back down the pack. But if it stays as is, Rossi will go to Le Mans, 2 points clear of Vinales and 4 clear of Marquez. I think that's what you call championship game on.
So do I. I think you'd call that, after finishing 10th and absolutely struggling the whole race, he's a very lucky boy.
I don't recall the race where Valentino Rossi's been overtaken by so many people, unless he's had a technical problem, because it's been a really difficult afternoon in front of the Spanish crowd for Rossi. No dramas for Pedrosa, who's over the line to start lap 24, and the gap again is 1.2. The lap times between the two Honda men, 140.8, 140.8.
Vizioso crosses the line in fifth. Vinales in sixth place. Now Petrucci, Folger, Aleix Espargaró and Valentino Rossi.
Rossi's just on a 145.4. Valentino Rossi has got to be careful here because his pace...
Letting the likes of Scott Redding, yeah. Morris Barnes, Hector Barbera, they're all there. Bradley Smith. He's having an absolute nightmare. He's leading the World Championship by 2 points as we stand at the moment. This is going to be a horrendous 3.5 laps for Valentino Rossi.
Rossi just wants to see the checkered flag right now. He's just praying that he can bring that motorcycle home because he's really, really struggling. 145.4 was Rossi's last time around. Danny Pedrosa was a 140.8, so Rossi was 4.4 seconds slower than the race leader.
Here is Marquez, Dennis Dillingshaw in second place. He's tried absolutely everything. He's still unsettled, Danny Pedrosa, when he's that far in front, but time-wise he's trying to unsettle him. It just has not worked out.
Is there a late sting in the tail? No, come down to 9/10.
Yeah. There'll be 3 laps to go when they cross the line. They're into turn 30. Let's just see what the gap is when they go over the line.
There's time. There's definitely time. Marc Marquez can claw back this deficit, but Dani Pedrosa's run a consistent pace. Yeah, it's 9/10. Pedrosa, for the first time in the race on lap 24, drops it to the 141s. Marquez stayed in that 148 bracket.
And for the first time in the race, it's less than 1 second when they actually cross the line. This is Zarco. What a ride by the double Moto 2 world champion into fifth place. Andrea Dovizioso in sixth. Vinales and Petrucci. Folger and Aleix Espargaró. And Valentino Rossi, who is struggling big, big time. But the gap is big enough between him and that group led by Scott Redding.
Well, all the talk was about would that medium option tyre be the choice for this race in the hot conditions. Well, we've got a medium rear tyre leading. Joel Lorenzo's on a medium rear in third. Zarco on that medium rear in fourth. Marc Marquez, what's the gap again? He's just been eked out to over a second by Pedrosa through the third split.
Just appears when there's not pressure, but any sort of hint of anything happening, he's just capable of going back to over a second advantage, doesn't he? It's a brilliant ride at the front by Danny Pedrosa. There's the helicopter shot on the two of them.
Yeah, you've got to say, Nick, as it stands right now, without wanting to put a curse on Danny Pedrosa, it looks like he's got this covered. Yeah, you look again, he's strong in that third sector. He's took a couple of tenths out of Marquez. Through turns 8, 9 and 10, and that fast sweep through turn 11 is where Danny Pedrosa's looked really strong all weekend.
This is Marquez, 2 laps to go and they cross the line here. Round 4 of the championship. Valentino Rossi really struggling down in 10th place but would still lead the championship.
Pedrosa's got the message. He dropped back into the 140s, a brilliant 147.54. That's his best lap for quite some time. And conversely, on the flip side of the coin, Marc Marquez dropped back into the 141s. So that time around, Pedrosa was able to stretch Marquez by 0.4 of a second. I think Marquez now is probably thinking about the championship, the risk over reward ratio. He's given everything to pressure Danny Pedrosa. The thing is, it's been perfect, Pedrosa. He's not put a foot wrong. Marc Marquez could do nothing more, but I think now he might be thinking, do you know what, I'll happily take those 20 points rather than try and take too many risks and end up in the gravel.
1.5 laps to go, down in the dry sack corner, on the brakes, Marquez running in second place and will close right up in the championship from Valentino Rossi and Maverick Vinales. Pedrosa's concentration and racecraft and the way he's handled the situation.
Oh, he's been out of the world champion, haven't they? Absolutely superb. It's like Danny Pedrosa rolling back the ears here, yeah. Isn't it? And of course, if he does continue this brilliant form here in Jerez, it will mean Danny Pedrosa would have won at least one Grand Prix every 16 successive seasons. Now that is a phenomenal record.
We ride with him.
It's over. Oh, Marc Marquez has decided he's settling for second place because Pedrosa's 2.2 seconds clear. He's done everything within his power, but he couldn't force Danny Pedrosa into making a mistake. And Marc Marquez now is thinking about the bigger picture. He's thinking about the long game and the World Championship. 20 points is all he could do today.
Yeah, 2.6 seconds now. Pedrosa leads away. Right over Marc Marquez. He just saw that speck in front. The versus Loris Baz and Hector Barber having a rare old scrap.
Rossi's gone back into the 144, so I don't think Scott Redding's going to be catching Valentino Rossi, but Rossi will be bringing that, well, I say bring it home, more like nursing that hot Yamaha home in 10th place.
Baz and Barbara. GP16 and the GP15.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah, here comes Danny Pedrosa then down to turn number 6 for the last time under absolutely no pressure whatsoever. 3.1 seconds now is his advantage. The 3,000th Grand Prix in history has been dominated by Danny Pedrosa.
Brilliant display at the front from the moment he went out there in the wet conditions on Friday morning. He looked very much a likely winner. Qualifying yesterday, he was prepared to go head-to-head with Marquez and show him who was the boss. And he certainly showed him in this race who is the boss.
Yeah, and he wasn't scared to run that medium tyre. We thought maybe on the Hondas they might need the hard option rear tyre, but Danny Pedrosa with his light size and his smooth riding style, not as aggressive as the likes of Cal Crutchlow and Marquez. It's been a tactical masterstroke to run that hard front Michelin rear tyre. And here he comes now down into the final corner. There'll be jubilant scenes here. History about to be made then for Danny Pedrosa in this milestone Grand Prix.
The 3,000th Grand Prix to be staged since 1949. And the winner, Danny Pedrosa here in Jerez.
Marc Marquez will bring it home in second place. He could not have done anything more to pressure Danny Pedrosa. Pedrosa, though, did not crack. He did not flinch. Brilliant third place for Jorge Lorenzo on the factory Ducati. His first podium in the colours of the Bologna factory. Great ride by Lorenzo. Back on the podium here in Jerez.
And Johan Zarco, what a ride by the Frenchman. Fourth place, coming after his 2 fifth places of the last two Grand Prix. Dovizioso Vinales, Petrucci, Folger. It should be a Leicester Spargo, and as Valentino Rossi got in 10th place.
Yeah, Rossi's about to limp over the finish line in 10th place. Nobody could have predicted that before the start of the race.
But he will still be leading the World Championship when we arrive in France at Le Mans by 2 precious points. But salute Danny Pedrosa, salute Jorge Lorenzo. They've been absolutely brilliant this afternoon.
Well, that's what the Spanish crowd would have wanted before the start of this race, an all-Spanish podium. Pedrosa, Marquez and Jorge Lorenzo. You've got to give full credit to Lorenzo. Came under a lot of pressure from Johan Zarco. Who didn't come under pressure from Johan Zarco in the early part of that race, to be honest?
A lot of fallers, unfortunately. Paul Espargaró, Alvaro, Batista, Jack Miller, Cal Crutchlow, Tito Rabat, Andrea Iannone. All crashing out. Got a bang on the head for Rabat. I think everybody else is okay. Great day for Honda. Certainly a big way to fight back. Of course, they were, what, first and third in Austin 2 weeks ago with the Yamaha and Rossi sandwiched between them. No chance this time round. And it's the Ducati of Lorenzo. Put it on the podium in third place.
Yeah, Danny Pedrosa, that start-to-finish victory. Hervé Poncharal will be absolutely delighted. High fives all round there. That's Christian Sauron in the blue shirt. He'll be pretty pleased to see a new French star in the Premier class, because that's exactly what this young man is. Johan Zarco, a quite brilliant ride to fourth place. Boy, did he get busy and aggressive in those first couple of laps. Some hard moves on the likes of Vinales and Rossi.
Here is Danny Pedrosa. And here is Marc Marquez with the flag. Yeah, 20 very pressure points for Marquez.
Yeah, he knew it when it came down to the last two or three laps. He'd done everything he possibly could, and Danny Pedrosa wasn't going to buckle under the pressure. So Marquez adopting the safety first approach and going, I'm going to look pretty silly launching it in a safe second place here. I need those 20 points to try and successfully defend this championship.
Great reception for Jorge Lorenzo.
What a morale boost for Lorenzo and the Ducati. That's brilliant.
That is absolutely superb.
That's great there to see as well. The man who you just saw congratulating Jorge Lorenzo, that was Michele Pirro, who's been doing such a great job spotting out on circuit for Jorge Lorenzo.
Well, Spain dominates. 1, 2, 3.
Marquez celebrating in front of his fan club.
Be careful, don't get... Oh, he's going to climb the fence, that.
What would he have done if he'd have won?
This is the stadium section here.
Who knows something about the man. Entirely happy to see Danny Pedrosa coming in to the number one place in Parc Fermé.
Well, we've seen quite a lot of Parc Fermé action today that's given us something to cheer about. I hope you're, if you're not watching it in sequence, then I'm going to try and remember not to spoil it for you this weekend.
I am going to say that the King of Spain is going to greet a rostrum full of his subjects in just a few minutes' time.
Honda are going to be happy, aren't they? Across the front row of the Moto3, across the front row of MotoGP, a 1-2 for the factory bikes in MotoGP. Just an outstanding day for Honda here in Jerez. Well, what a great day for the opening European round, Jules. This is where it really all begins, isn't it? Everything else feels like a...
There's his dad in the shades with a bit of a beard going on now.
Seti has joined them at the front here as well.
Let's have a look at Danny.
He's a much bigger lad, isn't he? It's got a lot of tyre pickup on there. That doesn't look
nothing
bad at all.
Nothing wrong with that, is there?
No, it's got a lot of rubber pickup where he's run round in the debris that's out on the track. Be interesting to see what the boys make of that, or hear what the boys make of JT and Neil Hodgson, of course. They're down in pit lane. I can't wait to hear their comments. Of course, we've got Checker Flag coming up after our main programme here that will analyse in a bit more depth what we've seen today across the classes. But what a good job from Danny Pedrosa. Yep. He paced it. I didn't know whether he was pacing himself or if that was his pace, but in the end he had that extra pace. Those last lap and a half, he really, really went for it, didn't he? Johann Zarco, though, best independent. That's why he's in Parc Fermé, of course.
Swapping greetings with Jorge Lorenzo, who he had a splendid fight with.
Yes, he did. Well, he had a splendid fight with everybody, didn't he, at some point?
Johann Zarco, he beat a few people up, he threw his elbows about. Selfie time.
Yeah.
Even Paolo Ciabatti is there, the ultra elegant dignified boss of Ducati course.
I wonder what Ducati's budget is when you see the amount of Ducatis, the amount of factory stuff there is down there in pit lane. It must be huge.
It's Lorenzo's relationship with Tardozzi that is crucial, isn't it? As Tardozzi's was with Carl Fogarty, with Troy Corsa and other Ducati riders.
I think it's crucial across the team, Jules. I think the Ducati, since DG Delinea came in, they are working as a team from factory to pit side.
Because GG, it wasn't a matter of the design, it's the management of the teams and systems that GG has improved. Dovi not looking unhappy with fifth place.
And he looked, when we saw him on the press conference on Thursday, Danny Pedrosa, it sounds strange, but he looked like a man. He looked like he'd matured. He looked like a dapper 30-year-old. And he's just done a fantastic job here in Jerez.
A lot of new faces in that corner.
That's
as well.
Exactly the point. What he's done is changed his whole team around. Seti Gibernau's come to join as well. And it's sort of bearing fruit already. Where is he in that championship again? Let's have a look. He's in fourth place on 52 points. Only 10 points off of Rossi on top. That's not a bad position to be at round four.
Not at all.
Danny Pedrosa to win a MotoGP championship.
I wish I'd put some money on. Let's hear from a man who's won three of them first, shall we?
Well, he's still celebrating along with Seti Gibernau and with Danny. Gives you some idea. Jorge's not that big. And so it gives you some perspective there regarding the size of little Dan. Let's hear from him then. Third place man, Jorge Lorenzo, on the Ducati. Not happy, is he? Look at that. Absolutely revving.
Well, Jorge, you must be extremely happy. Your first podium on the Ducati. I mean, how does it feel, especially after the difficult start to the season?
Well, it's like a victory, you know. Having podium with the Ducati, so special bike and so difficult bike, makes me very, very proud, very happy. I didn't expect that this position. I expected to fight for the fifth, sixth position. But anyway, the race pace was very slow, and I could little by little catch up and overtook some riders. So finally, I struggled so much to open this little gap from Zarco, but finally I never give up. I was very tired at the end of the race because this bike is a little bit nervous. So I push, and I stay on the bike, and I could enjoy. We can enjoy this result.
Fantastic. Thanks, Jorge. Congratulations.
Very proud, very happy. Those are two sets of words I didn't think I'd be hearing from Jorge. He had to work so hard for it as well, though. That's the fact.
Yes.
Now, he said the race pace is very slow. That was the other significant point of that as well for him. And that's what probably kept tyres in and the like for him. But he dealt with Iannone fairly swiftly. More mushroom there.
He went wide a few times early on, did Jorge, on a full tank and with the brand new tyre. But as you are seeing,
worked
he got
his way
it
through.
Together and worked hard. Zarco, tough nut to crack.
But well and truly cracked in that situation. Zarco's been fairly hard on other people. And Lorenzo was having none of it when it came to that pass on the Tech 3 Yamaha man.
Plenty of the black flags of Jorge Lorenzo's fan club around. Let's hear from Mark, shall we?
Well, Mark, congratulations. Second place here in Jerez. It looked like a tough race. You chose the hard option rear. Danny, the medium. In the end, we thought maybe you'd try and catch up. Did you ever think you'd catch him?
Yeah, honestly, I was pushing and trying to stay there 1 second, 1.5, 2, for try to attack in the end. But from the beginning, I feel that the front tire was too soft, had a lot of movement, was really critical. And then I know that in that condition, Danny is the best one. I mean, he's really smooth, he's pushing less than me on the break point, and I know that will be difficult, but even like this, I try until the end. But when remaining 3 laps, I had a big moment, and then I say, okay. I saw that the second position was a really good position here, really good end of weekend, and really happy because, you know, Jerez always I struggle, and here we were strong, so I have a lot of confidence.
Thank you very much, Mark. Congratulations.
Very interesting there that he obviously has matured so much that he's looking at the strengths that even his teammate has. Where are the strengths of Danny Pedrosa? The front end where he was struggling the most, he knew Danny would have a front end that was going to work right to the end of the race. And that for me is significant. He really, for 23, Julian, he really is the full package, isn't he?
He is the full, absolutely, Keith. That is a proper rider. Here is the winner.
Poor Danny, congratulations. An absolutely dominant win out there. You led from the start. I mean, how tough was it, though, in these conditions? And especially thinking that maybe Mark was giving you some pressure from behind.
Yes, it was an extremely hard race to be calm, because I wanted to go faster, but maybe the track condition was not there, and the feeling some corners was about to crash with the front. I had to pick the hard front, which was not my favorite. And I wasn't really riding very comfortable, so I had to be very, very focused every turn to be precise and to keep the rear tire, because I chose the medium compound. And it's true, at the end or middle of the race, Mark started to be fast and put some pressure, but I was able to control my pace and manage my lap times and my riding, and I'm very happy. So nice to win in this track. For my team and for myself, for my family, my friends, it's just amazing.
Thank you very much, Danny. Congratulations.
Super smooth. Danny Pedrosa sounds like he was having a difficult day as well, even though he was leading the pack. Let's have a look then at how the championship stands after round 4. Definitely closing up at the top there. Valentino now just leading by 2 points ahead of his teammate Maverick Viñales. Not a good day for the factory Yamahas. Marc Marquez in third on 58, just 4 points off the leader now. Danny Pedrosa up to fourth. Andrea Dovizioso's fifth. Jaron Zarco is sixth. Cal Crutchlow seventh. Eighth is Jonas Folger. Ninth, Jorge Lorenzo. And tenth is Danilo Petrucci. Interesting, James, what Mark was saying there about the difference now between the tyres, between the compounds, wasn't it?
That's just blown the championship wide open. And it's interesting to know why Danny Pedrosa has all of a sudden found some form. And I think Michelin this year have developed some tyres that feel a lot softer. And that's where he's getting the feeling from. He's always complained about the one make tyre rule, that tyres have been too hard for him. But I think that they're working in the, a range that he's happy with now. And they're too soft for the other guys. We've just heard Marc Marquez's braking is so much stronger than Danny's that he hasn't got the support there anymore, and that's what's brought the advantage that Danny's got compared to his teammate. But the advantage that Honda's had compared to the other manufacturers today, I think there must have been some inconsistency on the front tyres between the different riders. Rossi doesn't ride round in 42s when he's qualifying in 48, sorry, but it's a massive, huge difference. I'm sure they're very disappointed, but amazing results for Honda.
Well, incredible day for Honda, a red letter day for them, and they were, you know, all along the front row. Obviously, it wasn't to be Cal's day, but the factory Yamahas, there's a serious problem there, isn't there?
A real problem. I mean, Rossi had the worst of it. It's got to be some inconsistency of the performance from the front tyres. Rossi can't do those lap times. Viñales was really struggling as well, but the Hondas were 1 second at least per lap. than even third place Jorge Lorenzo, and he didn't look like he was having too many problems. So it was a good ride from Lorenzo, of course, being on the podium, but the other manufacturers watching the data after this race, looking at the Honda's pace in the 40s consistently, everybody else was between 41s and 43s. Just incredible, but it's nice to see the smile back on Jorge Lorenzo's face, just cuddling the king like you do.
Well, he's a great fan of MotoGP, been coming here for years and giving out the prize. He knows all of the boys extremely well, and you can't say enough good things about the man you're looking at now, Dani Pedrosa. Completely deserved that, but also Jorge Lorenzo. I don't think anybody had him on the podium, really, did they, this weekend? He looked strong, but when it came to the race pace, everybody thought, really, that, you know, a drop-off, especially having the medium tyre.
Yeah, Jorge Lorenzo made the difference this weekend. We know how strong he is around here. We know he's at home, and it's nice that he came with that mentality. I know the bike's not very good, but I'm going to make the difference this weekend. He said that on Friday morning before even getting on the bike, and it's that mentality has worked, and hopefully if he takes that into other races, hopefully the Ducati can be more competitive. But still, third place, when he looked at the times, he was quite a way off.
And we've got Le Mans next, which should be good for the Ducati, of course. Let's go and celebrate then with the crowd. They'll be loving it. Three Spanish riders on the podium today in MotoGP. Jules and Keith, it's been a good one if you're Spanish.
We're not Spanish, but we have enjoyed it. We hope you have at home as well on BT Sport. A massive crowd then here at Jerez to see just what they came for. Three Spanish riders on top of the podium, and the king is here as well. Not Mr. Rotolito,
no.
From the FIM, but Jorge Lorenzo, second place to Marc Márquez, third place for Lorenzo as he comes out to the podium, to the applause of Ducati. How happy is he with third place?
Unbelievable, Keith.
And of course, your Spanish Grand Prix winner, the 3,000th winner of a World Championship motorcycle race, road race, it is Dani Pedrosa.
Massive cheer from the home fans and mum.
Spanish Mother's Day today, and Dani Pedrosa is the man. Seti Gibernau there to the right. Wow, it's been a special kind of a day for the Spanish, hasn't it, really? Across the top of the podium.
It's going to get more special.
Head office.
Dani Pedrosa cheerleading. Oh, yes, a senior Honda man. Not team, head office.
Yeah.
Sent up to get the constructors' trophy. You know, there's some VIPs around when Mr. Hippolyto is only handing out the constructors' trophy.
Yeah, and I think we're going to have some proper...
This is the mayor of Jerez, a regular attender. Yeah. She's been mayor for as long as I can remember. She must be popular.
And well, Jorge has been the man around this racetrack for so long, she probably knows him very personally.
Yes. Great stuff from Jorge. Brilliant for Ducati and utterly brilliant for the championship.
Marc Márquez gets congratulations, as did Dani Pedrosa.
And now Andalusian minister, that's the regional government. This is a big event, so it's the tourism and sports minister who comes out in his best suit to hand Marc Márquez his trophy. Just the 92nd Grand Prix trophy Marc has in the cabinet. Jorge, by the way, now is 146.
I'm glad they're taking their time with this, because it's good
yes.
fun. It's good fun listening to the crowd winding up the whole thing. And here he is,
His
King Juan Carlos.
King Juan Carlos Bourbon, King of Spain. Not just the man who oversaw Spain's move to democracy. He made Lorenzo and Pedrosa shake hands on the rostrum all those years ago.
Which, as far as we're concerned, is an even bigger deal.
Bigger achievement. And the king, a motorcyclist in his younger days, a very key motorcyclist, hands one of his subjects the winner's trophy for Dani Pedrosa, his 53rd, his 30th in this, the top class. Cheerleading from His Majesty.
Been a long time coming, this win for Dani Pedrosa, since 2013 here in Jerez.
We're going to hear now the Royal March, the national anthem of Spain. There are no words to it, it's just music, but you're going to enjoy it anyway, aren't you?
there you have it then, super smooth. Danny Pedrosa, his first win since Misano last year. And no one deserved it more, session after session this weekend. He hit the top spot. The Spanish Grand Prix this weekend has been owned by that man, Danny Pedrosa, the 3,000th Grand Prix. And great for the championship. Marc Marquez celebrating there. And as the champagne flows, of course, there's plenty more to talk about. But lots more live sport today on BT Sport. If you fancy a couple of extra wheels, it's the opening round of the German Touring Car Championship, the DTM, over on ESPN HD. Also, ladies tennis, the WTA are in action on 2HD Extra at the Madrid Open. At 2:15, there's football from the Bundesliga, Hamburg versus Mainz. And more football, the Vanarabe National League have their playoff semi-final between Forest Green Rovers and Dagenham and Redbridge. Finally balanced from the first leg that was 1-1. But of course you can stay with us. Yeah, do that. Right here on Czech and Flag.